Greetings.
Hi, how are you?
I'm listening.
Great to meet you.
Ah, I've been expecting you.
For the good of all.
You come get the voodoo.
Hey there.
And you are?
Light be with you.
Hey, great to meet you.
You come to consult the spirits?
Welcome to Orgrimmar. Have you come to serve the Horde?
Sail here, me by, and trade. What?
Sail here, me by, and trade. What?
Hello and welcome to Control Alt WoW, the podcast for those of us who love World of Warcraft and many other games and love making many alts. Today is Sunday, May 22nd, 2022, and this is episode 748. Is the housing bug exterminated now? I'm Aprillian, your host, and with me are my two awesome co-hosts. Constrax, how are things going?
Good, other than I couldn't quite participate with the critter week.
Oh.
It was the bug, the critter leveling stuff, and I just didn't have a lot of time to play, so I was kind of sad about that.
Yeah.
Because I like leveling stuff.
Right. It's very therapeutic.
Yes.
And Grand Negus, how are you?
I'm good. I can't say anything else. I've been playing quite a bit and leveling quite a bit. So,
nice.
And IRL, everything is fine. So I'm good.
Well, I just want to apologize to everybody because I had to cancel out last week. This back thing was really inflamed. And so this week I decided to took a long nap before I started. I took some ibuprofen. Hopefully that'll help. And I put on a new lidocaine patch. So, yeah.
You are prepared.
Yes, I am prepared. And speaking of prepared, I am working on a new computer today, so wish me luck. I put my PC in the living room, and I'm playing on my old iMac. And, did you know that the Intel iMac is not really meant for WoW anymore? So you have to upgrade to a different level of operating system. So if anybody's playing on the Mac, let me know. I don't know if too many people play, but let me know what your experience is playing on the Intel. Because, you know, there's two different ones now. The regular one that I record on is the one that has the Apple chip. And that's
different. The M1?
Yes, the M1. And that's fine. But the other one, my old one that I'm using right now, it's like, oh no, you can't use this. You need to upgrade.
That's interesting, because I haven't heard anything from Blizzard about this they introduced.
Oh, well, maybe I should. Did I screenshot? I think I screenshotted the note that it told me. But there's certain recommendations for backwards compatible. And, I mean, even though it just crashed. It just stopped running. Oh, well. We'll see what happens.
For my computer, it keeps telling me it's not Windows 11 compatible.
Oh.
So, I don't know. That's good and bad. I hope it's not bad.
I run Windows 11, and I haven't had a single issue.
No, my computer's not good enough to run Windows 11.
Oh, your computer.
Oh. We're talking about WoW now, so that's a totally different thing. Yeah, sure, it is, because you need to have a certain, was it MTMS, something?
Yeah, there's a score.
TRM, I don't know what the thing is called.
Yeah.
It's like a module, either be on the on the chipset,
right?
On the CPU,
yeah.
Integrated or a external module that you
I got the best CPU I could afford at the time, which was the, like the high end, but yeah, that but was several generations ago.
Exactly, and since I don't know when they started making the integrated version of that thing that you need TRM, I think it's called. Yeah, if you don't have that, or if you don't have, I don't know what else, there was like one more thing that is like mandatory now.
Yeah.
Then it just won't. I mean, there are, we don't want to go into this too much because right. it's, I don't want to say illegal.
But, there are ways around it, yeah.
Uh-huh.
There are ways around it, some ways, and illegal is such a strong word in that... basically, you buy a product and yeah. Microsoft can't do anything about it. The best thing for them is that they cancel support.
Yeah.
So that means that either you run your system the way you do and live with the consequences of your yeah. actions. And Microsoft says, yeah, you did this, that, and the other, and therefore either we are just not going to support your software anymore, or they outright block the software from working.
Right.
So, obviously they cannot go and tell you that you done something criminal. Because you just can't do anything criminal by just running the operating system. If you do something with the operating system, like hack or whatnot, that's another thing. But by just running the operating system in a way that Microsoft doesn't intend you to, there's no way that they can come after you for that. So, at least not to my knowledge. I don't know what Canada's law says or what other countries' law said, but it would surprise me greatly. So
interesting enough, though, Final Fantasy 14 is running fine.
Nice.
The only problem I did have, and which is why I messaged you on Twitter the other day, was I couldn't figure out where to download my Mac version.
Right.
I found it. I figured it out. By the time you got back to me, I had figured it out. But
yeah, okay.
You do have to jump through a couple of hoops.
Yeah, I mean, to tell people where they can download it, basically, if I remember correctly, you can go to the website of Square Enix.
Right.
And let me make this clear that this is why I bring this up. I am unfortunate enough, I must say, to play a Steam version of the game.
Oh, there's nothing wrong.
There's nothing wrong with the Steam version, not at all.
Right.
But the hook that Steam has in you means that whenever something happens, if something should happen with your link to Steam or Steam itself, you cannot play the game.
Right.
Oh, no.
The other thing is, for me, Steam payment is way more comfortable than the Square Enix payment. So there is a good and bad kind of thing, but if I had to suggest something to people that aren't playing yet, don't play the Steam version. Go to the website, the proper Square Enix website, and download the client there. Buy the game there, because it's just not worth having that that detour through Steam, where you have to connect your Steam account to your Square Enix account.
Oh yeah, I bet.
And this, that, and the other. There are so many downsides to that. So yeah, it's just not worth it, in my opinion. So yeah, that little.
All right. So what's going on this week?
This week we have a couple of things going on. Let me just scroll up in the show notes. Where are we? There we are. We have on the 27th, we have the Glowcap Festival coming up. Ending on Tuesday, we have the Torghast event.
The Glowcap Festival, that's the Sporgar in Zangarmarsch Outland, right?
Yes, correct.
Okay, right. Okay.
Do you get a pet?
Excuse me?
Do you get a pet?
You can get the normal pet from doing the rep grind, yeah, but yeah, there's no special anything. I don't think there's any micro holiday that gives you anything substantial. And it's not supposed to. It's just a little something to do.
Yeah, yeah.
And they've said that from the beginning when they started having the micro holidays. I think it's basically bragging rights, much like the very first one was the holiday in Sedithus, where you could do your PvP stuff, and then at the end of the event, the winning faction would get bragging rights with their flags on the outside of Anchorage.
Oh yeah, right.
For six months or so.
For a year. Because that event only comes around in January each year, right. So it's 1 year of bragging rights. Yep. And they said that would be the maximum of things that you could get out of it.
Right.
So, yeah. Chorus of the Dead Souls, the Torghast event. And it is kind of a strange time. Normally you have it at the end of a month, like in the week that bridges the month. This time it's like in the middle of the month. Mm. I don't know what's going on there, but yeah. Maybe it's a calendar fluke again. That God knows there have been quite a few of those. Mm-hmm. Arena Skirmish bonus event ends as well, and the PvP Brawl Cooking Impossible. On Tuesday, we start having a time walking event, Wrath of the Lich King, and the PvP Brawl Temple of Hot Mogu.
Right.
So, yeah, with the news, we only have a few items there. One is the let me see. This is from the other day. We don't need that anymore.
Housekeeping.
So we have had in the last week and a half, we've had a few bans happening in FF14 because people were using third-party tools that they shouldn't have.
Oh.
That is a thing that Square Enix says. Basically, it's like use them at your own discretion. Right. We won't do anything if you don't display them, if you don't show them, if you don't talk about them,
right,
about using them, something to that effect. But kind of a lot, I don't want to say, quite a few streamers thought that, put caution to the wind and let's just stream with them showing.
Oh, dear.
So, Square Enix said, we can't have that. And since...
Makes sense. Yes? It makes sense. I mean, you know.
Yeah, it does. It does make sense. We have had quite a few PvP third-party add-ons or tools or whatever you want to call them to really cheat in PvP, like teleport add-ons and whatnot or tools. And since the new patch came out, the 6.1, and the introduction of the crystalline conflict, the new PvP mode, that has been a big issue. So I think that Square Enix has said with those tools being used now, and then that's bad. So we can go and go after other people as well that just are blatantly, obviously displaying their use of add-ons, much like, for instance, the most obvious add-on to be displayed from what I've seen is a damage meter.
Right.
And damage meters aren't supposed to be used. So, and you can see in some streams from some people that they have, like in WoW, we have Recount and SCADA and whatever other add-ons are being used. The same type of window with the bars indicating what tune does how much damage. And those add-ons apparently are displayable outside of the screen, outside of the window that is the game. So you can have your second and third monitor displaying those windows. So why not do it? It's totally beyond me. And if you stream and you know that's a thing that you shouldn't do,
right?
I just don't see why they do it. Because you get banned, you get actions taken against you, suspended. There are quite a few. Let me just quickly see if I have the numbers here. They've had a post about this, actions taken against in-game RMT, real money trading, and other illicit activities. So what they've said here in this post is that in the time period between May 12th and May 18th, so 6 days, participation in RMT or other prohibited activities, accounts terminated, which in my book means terminated as in completely destroyed,
right,
put to rest.
Shut down.
Terminated, yeah. 3,718. Accounts temporarily suspended, which is a temporarily thing, 5. And then from pure RMT advertising, accounts terminated 2,433. So if you play the game and you see the advertisements in chat and you tell yourself, oh, well, it doesn't matter and how much, what's going to happen? Nothing is going to happen to those spammers, gold sellers anyway. Yeah. 3,700 and 2,400, that's more than 6,000 accounts terminated. That's not nothing.
No, not at all.
I mean, it's a drop in the bucket compared to a couple of million. Yes, sure.
Right.
But how many people, how many accounts spam in the chat versus play the game and don't spam in chat? It's 6,000 or above 6,000 is quite a few. So I think so. Yeah, you can understand why you should, in my opinion, you should report these people. So the ban hammer has been brought down. They have Yoshida-san has talked about this problem in the post and has made his point or the point of the company clear. So, I mean, I would go so far as to say, I mean, obviously you cannot, but well, technically you can if you see the person
streaming, right?
You could go and report that person for unlawful for actions that aren't or not in line with the with the terms of service,
right?
So, and I wouldn't blame you because it destroys the game for everyone,
right?
If you go and use cheating add-ons in PvP, that makes the other nine people's gaming experience so much worse. Yes, the game, the team that you are on while cheating might win, but it's still not a fair win.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm not a big fan of it. The other point I wanted to make is the fact that they've on the 18th, they've had Final Fantasy 14 has had a maintenance period, and they have applied a fix for a supposed fix for the housing bug issue, so that people that now that have applied for a house in the lottery in the form of a lottery, buying a lottery ticket, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
And haven't been able to have a proper auction on their plot, they can now go and check on that plot and see if they've won on the placard outside of the plot.
Nice.
should you not have redeemed your money from the
Right, you had to leave your money in the pot.
Have you done that? Then it's all fine. Were you one of the people that have taken the money out of the pot? You will still get your house.
Oh.
So you will get essentially a free house.
Oh, wow.
Regardless of how much that would cost.
Wow.
Now, Yoshida-san has said they are going to implement with 6.2 an NPC where you could voluntarily pay that sum of money that you had to spend on the housing plot if you were to have taken it out again. So, but you don't have to. It's voluntary.
Right.
But they would give you, they will give you the chance to pay that money should you feel obligated, inclined, willing to do so. They won't prevent you from doing it, and that's the method to do it. Many people have laughed at it. I feel that it's something that shows me that this game is a Japanese game. And right. Honor and etiquette and whatever you want to call it.
Customer service?
No, it's not customer service, because why would you, if you have a house for 35 million gil, why, and you got that for free, why would you go and pay that gil to an NPC?
Right.
So, again, it's an honor thing, it's an etiquette thing. I totally see that is part of the Japanese culture.
Mm-hmm.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I totally see that from what little I know about Japanese culture, it's just a thing that that fits.
Mm-hmm.
And thankfully I'm not in that situation. I have to decide, am I going to pay the money or not for the house that I got? So, yeah. The next lottery round is going to start, I think, on the 25th, if I remember correctly. For the people that watch live, or for the people that
listen to
this on Monday, we are going to have a maintenance period on Tuesday. So there is one more upcoming. I don't know what specifically the maintenance period is for. Usually they tell us what they want to fix or do, because it, as I've talked about before, Final Fantasy is not a game that has a regular weekly maintenance schedule. It's just when it's necessary, they're going to do one. So, yeah, on the 24th, which is Tuesday. Let me see if the housing transfer is being abandoned or is being 30 minutes before. No, they don't say anything about what's going to be fixed. Yeah, so if you don't have a house yet, you still have the chance to get one come Wednesday. In order to implement 6.11a patch. There is the reason. Mm. No patch notes, but 6.11a is the reason why they are going to implement, or what they are going to run the maintenance. If I find anything, I'm going to get back to you guys next week if I should find anything. We still have 6.15 and 6.18 to go in this patch cycle. And then in August, we're going to get 6.2. So, but that's like far off. Yeah, and that's basically what we have with regards to news. Let me just see if there's anything that I missed. I think there was one thing that I wanted to mention that I hadn't, that didn't get into the patch notes. Here we go. Blizzard has, the other way around. There is apparently a new untitled Dragonflight prequel book added to the Amazon websites.
Oh.
And the release date of that book, according to an Amazon website, I don't know which one it is, what region it's in, is November the 22nd. So 112222. They have all these 112222 things. As of late with this year, it's quite funny. So that means we are definitely not going to see the expansion launch this year. I'm just going to say it because I highly doubt that release date will stand. With Sylvanas, the original date was sometime in November, then it got pushed back to December, right. Then February, and then April, I think, is when it really came out, I think. So 4 delays. I mean, yeah, sure, they could be on track to release it. But still, if you think about what people should have, will need time to read the book and digest the content.
Right.
Right.
So November the 22nd is 5.5 weeks before year's end. And I don't think that stay with the metaphor. The is not a sufficient digestion period to get through the content of the book so I can't remember who said it. I think it was Bellula talked about a Q1, late Q1. early Q2, and I think that's what I said a couple of times here already as well. March, April, something like that should be the earliest time when we're going to see Dragonflight. Really curious as to see what content the book will have. My guess of a potential story, let's just put it that way, if I were a writer and Blizzard would tell me what can you tell?
Right.
What kind of story can you tell? I would go with as one thing. There was this book called Aspects of the Dragon. Like the book that we had where we got the story of how the aspects became aspects.
Mm. Right.
With all the story, you remember when you go to Dragonblight, you right. see the big Galakrond bones of the big dragon,
right?
North of Wormrest, where all the skeletons, all the undead,
right,
where they hang out. That dragon played a big part in the story of that book, how it was how he was defeated, because obviously he was defeated, because otherwise he wouldn't be dead.
Right.
So and that had consequences for the entire dragon, for all of dragonkind. That's how you phrase it. And after that, the aspects were made aspects. How, I'm not, obviously not going to spoil it, because people might want to catch up on the book before the expansion.
Right.
And the book is called Dawn of the Aspects.
Dawn of the Aspects.
It's written by Richard Knack. It's one of the better stories. The only thing that I didn't like about it was the ending. It was a little cut off. In light of why and the fact that we have Dragonflight coming now, that might be, again, as I said, to
might be a spoiler,
come yeah. full circle to the to what I said earlier, what I might want to suggest when it comes to a story, is that to pick up there and then tell the story from that point on forward until the Sundering, where the planet got sundered into the continents that we know now, and then that's we saw that in the trailer, in the cinematic that they showed when they announced the game, that's why and when the Dragon Isles got hidden.
Mm-hmm.
if you watch the cinematic at the start, you see the clouds gathering overhead, and you see the green fell clouds in the distance. That's when the invasion, the Burning Legion invasion happens. So the period between the dawn of the aspect and that point where the cinematic starts, and then another B plot or a B plot for me would be, since we have the Draxir coming now, the new race and class, the Draxir Evoker.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What made Neltharion, aka Deathwing, what made him create those? What for? We know that they are his army. They've said that. Mm-hmm. But for what? To fight what? Right. How did he create them? What
was created his motivation?
What was his motivation? Second in command, like the structure of his army, stuff like that. That would be interesting to like introduce characters that we are going to interact with. The primals, those other opposed dragons that don't want anything to do with the aspects and with the titans, to introduce those. I think the A plot and then that B plot, that would be one of the ideas that I might want to know more about. So it's something where I can say that I would really like that very much to know more about that. Yeah, and beyond that, I don't think there is much to talk about with regards to news. Mm. We have a couple of things that we can talk about over the next few weeks when it comes to stuff that now have been hidden or have been encoded in the PTR.
Right.
Where there's stuff that you're not supposed to see. Some content creators think that might have to do with an allied race that we're going to see for reasons that are reflected by quests in the game and stuff like that. I'm not going to get my hopes up with regards to Dark Rangers, but at this point, I don't know what will bring me back, but that's not a thing. Oh yeah, one more thing. I'm just seeing this now. Apparently, Curseforge, aka Overwolf, there we go, has their new official AIP, has launched it or is about to, and they have apparently launched a app. A Overwolf app. So you can manage your add-ons. So if you want to use that, you can now do that. I think to download the client, standalone Windows client, go to, yeah, so the CurseForge website has the client to available for download on Windows, on Mac, and on Linux. So that's, and I would think that it's quite likely that with the launch of the API, the other third-party management client for add-ons should lose access, as indicated by Overwolf in the very near future. A couple of weeks or a couple of months ago, we were wondering when they were going to cut access. And obviously, we didn't have any idea yet why, but for me, this is quite a big indication that, this is quite imminent. So, because they have their own new API now, of new CurseForge official API. So anything that's not official, AKA stuff that is not people that are, or websites that are not supportive of the API or that are not supported by access granted from Overwolf should lose the interactivity with the game pretty soon, I would assume. So, yeah, now finally I'm done. So, yeah.
That's a lot to digest, but thank you for sharing with us, Granny.
Your piece.
Let's get to our
Set my piece.
I've had a fantastic weekend. Wow. It's very comforting. Those battlegrounds where you're not necessarily putting out more damage, but you feel like you're contributing more by pushing all the buttons all at once. Bad boy. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you?
Constructs, how's your weekend WoW going?
My week was kind of lopsided. I was horribly tired, and I tried to do my transmutes every day, and I missed like two or three days, and then I went back to look at the auction house, and a lot of people moved in on the Vile of Sands market, so I had a lot of competition from the days that I couldn't do it, so it happens. I mean, you build up a market and you try to take care of your customers, but eventually if you're not there every day watching what's going on, somebody else can swoop in and undercut you by one gold. So it is what it is. That's all it takes. Yeah. So I'm trying to get back into the game and trying to be productive on the weekend. And my Valpyra rogue is actually climbing up the ranks. I've gotten some more gear from the auction house, because once you have all the heirlooms, you only have like three or four slots to worry about: the feet, the belt, the hands, and the wrist. Everything else is covered by heirlooms.
Right.
So that's not, you know, and I had too many auctions. I had way over 200 auctions. I thought, you know, I just need to dump some stuff and not feel bad about it. So I listed some stuff for like 2 gold, 3 gold. Just like, take it. This is chat, vendor it, do whatever you want with it. And I had quite a few sales. And then I went back to look for stuff to buy, and it was like 5-6 gold. I was like, okay, I mean, you can't really complain about that.
Yeah, you can't. No.
So I think that the market had like an adjustment period. And so now I kind of want to level some alts. I got invited on Thursday. Thursday, I was back in from work a little bit early, and I had stuff in the oven for an hour. And my GM just goes, come to the raid. Come to the raid. Come on. Come to the raid. I'm like, okay. So we went and defeated the jailer. My first move was to promptly step into a door, a hole into the floor and die. So after the first wipe, I waited for the buff to be cast on me. Then I stepped into a hole. I closed the hole. But got knocked into another hole and died.
Oh, no.
So I was the only one on that pole that died. Everybody else made it through the jailer fight. And people on Discord are going, DBM's saying, move away now. And the entire floor is covered by like a defile mechanic. And it's like, thanks, DBM. Move where? Mechanic from like the Lich King days, and everything is the entire floor, the entire room is covered with the file. It's like, huh? So it's like a burn mechanic where you have either the jailer is going to get you or you're going to get the jailer. So, like, one person's going to win. So, it was quite a nice fight. I enjoyed it. And my GM traded me a trinket, a 259 trinket. From normal, which basically puts a spike into a target and then yanks me to that target. So that's kind of nice. it's like a grappling hook mechanic that you apply. So I've just had a chance to try it in game. It's quite interesting. As far as Vile Descend's gathering, I have over 5,000 volatile life, so set up for a few months for volatile life. I don't have all the other volatiles. I have like 1,000 volatile waters, but every day I make 2 transmutes of it, and I have volatile fire. I go fish in Twilight Highlands and Mount Hyjal. There's Pit of Sauron thing there, the Lake of Fire and the Cauldron of Flame, and you just fish there, and you're bound to get 1 to 2 volatile fires. So I put on my my bobbers, my tugboat bobbers, and my Murloc bobber. I just watch a movie and I fish, and I have it on 2 screens. So basically, I'm farming on 2 accounts on the same realm. So there's nobody there to compete with you. I mean, if you have fine fish and your skills, it'll pop up on the screen when there's a new pool, and it'll take maybe 5 minutes. You have to wait while you're doing that. You're fishing on the other screen, so it interacts with the other one, and your movie's just playing. And I'm currently watching Sustainable War, Ghost in the Shell, basically on Netflix. So I started a season of that, so I don't know where that's going to take me, but so far it's interesting. I just started farming Vortex Pinnacle for Volatile Air. So basically before the first boss, I jump off the ledge and I start reset the instance, and I can kill the empowered elementals in there, and I put on heroic. I get a few more volatiles. So in one timeout, like in 1 hour, I got 99 volatiles. So that wasn't too bad. And basically after you do that, you could go farm some whiptail. So that gets, cause you're already in Uldum. And at the same time, on the other screen, while I wait for Whiptail to regenerate, I put my my Vulpira Rogue back in Twilight Highlands to fish the pools for volatile fires. So basically, I don't run out of stuff to do. I just a matter of gathering while other people are hogging the market, so to speak. I found that this... the pools of albino cavefish and deep hole don't regenerate really fast. I don't know what it is. I think they regenerate like once every hour or once every 2 hours. So there's a mechanic there that I'm not familiar with. So I don't know if there's a way to speed it up or if you have to jump to a different realm to hopefully pull some more volatiles, but or more albino cavefish. Because I want to be ahead like 10 vials or whatnot on that realm where I'm selling them. My GM sold one for me, so that was kind of nice of him. It went for 75K, and I don't have to sit in trade chat for hours begging for somebody to buy my vial. So he sold one, so that was nice of him for me. I split the profit with him. That was good. I don't have to do too much work, but he's known on that realm, so that helps that he has a lot of contacts. I'm really enjoying the auction house, but I think it's a little bit wearing me down to have 200-300 auctions. So that's why I want to thin out the number of my auctions to something more manageable, maybe 50 or 60 auctions. So I can list in a couple minutes with trade skill master add-on. The fishing... For the pools of fire, what I do when I want fishing is I go to Stranglethorn Vale and I look for those pools with the chests, and I get the weather-beaten fishing hat out of there, and I get also the Fish Don't Leave Footprints book, which teaches you the scale of fishing. So that's usually what I do is when I want fishing on a character, I'll make sure I have that. And then back in... Pandaria, I got the raft for the anglers. So if I go to deep home, I can float on the water. I think you're muted, really. Sorry. So I can float on the water. It's called the anglers fishing raft. Cool. So you can float for 10 minutes. And it doesn't matter if you're shape-shifted or whatnot. You just sail across the water. You hit the space bar. You float a little faster. So it helps to have the sound on when you're fishing, because if you're watching a movie, you can still hear the swoosh,
right,
of the bobber when you catch a fish. So you can still right click on it. I've changed my looting to auto loot with the right click, so I don't have to. Right click and then left click to pick up the stuff. I right click and it picks up everything as if I was holding the shift key. So that's kind of nice, a nice key bind. Some of the people in my server I play on, they're into PvP because they wanted to get the season 3 transmog.
Right.
So I might have to learn PvP on a druid. It scares me because that's why I hate fighting the worst is druids. They're so good at having survivability and self-heals. So I have to get with somebody to kind of duel with them to kind of pick up the tricks. And hopefully I can hold my own and figure out a way to defeat them for when I need to fight them with my rogue. My Vulpira is assassination, so it's kind of different when you're fighting assassination because you have a 150 energy instead of 100, so it's kind of like you have more bursts when you start, but then it trickles down as you as the fight wears on. So you sort of have to manage your energy, and the double slash maneuver is really powerful, but it does like drain your energy real fast. So I think probably go to IC veins and figure out the rotation to maximize that profession. Right now I'm just doing willy-nilly damage. Sometimes I'm at the top of the DPS, sometimes at the bottom of the DPS. I do sharpen my daggers because I like that mechanic where you you get a sharpening stone and you add plus one or plus two or plus four to your damage. Later on in Shadowlands, you get attack power, but in the classic Cataclysm, you have the plus so many damage. So I like being top of the meter when I can, but I don't like consuming flasks if I can help it. I am leveling enchanting. I figured out that you can buy vellums, you can buy strange dust, you can buy the lesser magical essence, and if you make the lower enchants with vellum, you can vendor them back for the same cost as what you pay for them, really. So you don't have to spend weeks on the auction house trying to get rid of your enchants that you don't want, because you buy and sell for the same price at the enchanting vendor. So it really doesn't cost you anything to level. I used to make the bracers back in the day, the cloth bracers, linen cloth bracers. I used to sell a bunch of those, but it's like, you can only sell them for like one gold or 33 silver. So like, I don't know if I want to resurrect that market now that everything's been nerfed with the nerfing of the level squish. The herb market is kind of volatile on the server I play on. Some herbs go for 33 gold, other herbs go for 24, and it seems to vary with every week what everybody wants. Right. Sometimes I sell Twilight Jasmine for 40 gold each, and I can never tell which week those are going to be, but I think it's tied with when the Dark Moon Fair comes around. People try to quickly levels through some portions of the leveling curve without having too much trouble, and they'd rather go to the auction house and go farm it themselves. Or it's possible they don't have the herbing skill at all and then they're left to buy whatever's on there. For example, some week I get 4,000 or 5,000 gold a day at the auction house, and other weeks I get less than 200 gold a day. I can never plan or prepare ahead of time for how much I'm going to make, because it's so random. But on a busy server, you have more action on the auction house than you do like on a low population server. My server on Thorian Brotherhood, I'm kind of at a loss to do what to do, because I haven't sold anything on that server for like weeks. People are just so aggressive and undercutting on that server. I'm not able to sell anything. When I do get a sale, it's like, ooh, like, because I have like 3.5 million on that server. So I'm hoping to get to 5 million so I can put a bid on the black market auction house if the Brutosaurus comes up. But I'm told people gold cap the bidding on that one. So I'm like,
oh, yeah, sure.
That means that 5 million is not going to be enough to get the winning bid. So
be better
to have 10 million and just cap it at 10 million right away. So I don't know how to get 10 million. I used to have, during Cataclysm, I had 12 million in sales, but I don't have sales like that anymore. It's like, now it's more normal, you know, like a couple hundred thousand gold a month or whatnot. I had, 3 weeks ago, I had 400K in sales for one week.
Oh, wow.
So I was really happy. It wasn't all profit, but I was like, okay, 400K, that means I can afford to splurge and make gifts. So I made a few gifts. There's one main tank in our guild, and there's a co-tank who didn't have the mount vial of the sand. So I donated one to him. I said, here you have it. He goes, I already have the recipe on another realm. I go, well, you can donate it or you can learn it. It's not for me to tell you what to do with it. And I was happy to learn that he consumed it. He earned a mount. So that made me feel good to do something for somebody who does stuff for everybody else on the guild, who doesn't mind co-tanking the raids. So they're involved in the guild day-to-day activities. I got to go beat the jailer, so I got the Grand Design achievement.
Oh,
right, nice. Now I'm on my way back to Vortex Pinnacle to go farm some more air, because I want to have I have 131 true gold. So that's not that hard to earn, but if you sell a vial every time you consume 12 true gold, so that means 144 is like 12 vials. So it's not too bad. But to give you an example, on my server, Thorian Brotherhood, where I'm not able to sell anything, I have 480 true gold.
Why aren't you able to sell? Oh, because there's no market?
The people undercut me every time I list something.
Oh, wow.
So they've learned my habits. They've learned my listing times. They've learned how to be there every time I try to undercut them, and they've learned to list for like next to no profit. So it's like, how do you beat them? Like they know your schedule. They have you on their friends list, but when you log on, they wait for you to log off to go check what you just did.
Oh, that is so sneaky.
Well, you know, it happens. Like. I do the same with competitors, people who who beat me all the time on my auctions. I add them to my friends list so I can see what they're doing.
Oh, okay.
When they log in, what you do is you don't say anything. You don't talk to them.
You go straight to the auction house.
You wait for them to log off and you check what they're doing. I know, it's very sneaky.
Yes.
Somebody on Discord was asking, who's this Constracts person? I go, it's such and such on the guild. They're like, oh, okay. I don't have to kick you. It's like, no, please don't kick me. So I could actually, I didn't know any of the mechanics at the rain. So I'm approaching Vortex Pinnacle. Or Vortex Pinnacle is a quick instance. If you're a druid, you can run up the first corridor and just do like a big, What's that move called? The swipe, which puts a bleed on everything all around.
Oh yeah, right.
I forget what it's called. Let me land. Here we go. It's called trash. So you do a trash, and you basically kill off all the mobs that are close to you, and then you do one loot with the auto loot, and you pick up 2 to 9 volatile airs with one click, and depending on which mob you're at. And then at the end, before the first boss, you jump off so you're not saved to that instance. So you can reset it over and over. Yeah.
And you don't die.
Well, I mean, you're level 60. Why would you die?
From jumping over the edge.
Yeah. It's a mechanic for Vortex Pinnacle. Yeah. It doesn't kill you.
Exactly. My point. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. Sometimes I resize my screen and it blocks my keys to it changes the size of my action bars.
Oh.
And then it don't work anymore. I don't know why.
That's not fair.
No.
It's probably one of my add-ons that is acting up. So I try to go back in. It's not letting me. I've been too many times, I think. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Still saying I've been been there too many times in the last hour. So I'll just go fishing in Violet Highlands and just pick up some twilight flowers, twilight jasmine, and those sell for like 40 gold on their shop. I don't know why. Other than leveling, I don't know what flask you can make for them from them.
Maybe something to do with ink, making ink.
Yeah.
No.
No.
Also,
they're way too valuable to turn into ink.
Yeah.
What are they used for then?
Gold each. Whiptail usually you can sell for 1 to 2 gold each, but right now they're selling for 34 gold on my server, so I'm selling them. Why not? I think a lot of people are leveling alts because I see all level of peoples in Ogrimmar. Ogrimmar is just packed. Like you go in there and there's people everywhere. Mm-hmm. So that's nice. It's nice to see a lot of people playing WoW and like I don't run out of stuff to do. I just run out of energy to stay awake at the keyboard. I fall asleep sometimes in the chair. I don't know why.
That's dedication.
Yeah, my time's limited, so I really appreciate my wife can spare a few moments for me to play. But we make dinner early, and we try and have a here we go, volatile fires. That's so easy. Like if you know when the timers are gonna go. You don't have to work really hard to gather the mats.
Mm.
It helps to have two accounts because you can be in two places at once.
Oh,
you don't spend as much on travel time. And I wish I had my third account back, but I can't afford it right now. I have to wait maybe a few more weeks. Hopefully my wife won $1,000 on the lottery.
Oh, congrats.
I go, what? How'd that happen? And so I looked up and she got 5 out of 7+. I'm like, wow, nice. one more number would have been a lot more zeros. And so that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
And I don't know what we're going to do with the money, but I'm sure it'll be well spent. That's pretty much been my week. I hope everybody has a good time in game and that real life doesn't hit too hard because I know for me, when it hits hard, it's hard to recover.
Yeah, it can be rough. All right.
Yeah, Twilight Jasmine is used for flasks.
Is it?
For Draconic Mind and for Steel Skin.
Ah, yeah.
So, tanking and intellect.
Right.
Or stamina, which is for tanking. So, yeah.
Right.
Okay, that makes sense. All right.
And to transmute a demon, demon's eye, a gem.
Right. So, yeah. To level.
Healing potion. Yep.
Oh, excellent.
Oh. How you doing?
I get giddy and love making mini alts. My dog is trying to poop for the horn. And for the alliance. It was funny on my head.
Brilliant. How was your week in gaming?
My week in gaming has been much better than last week. We had to cancel because I got this pain in my shoulder, and it makes it hard for me to play, but it also makes it hard for me to even sit at keyboard. But I've been nursing it. I've been taking my time and not pushing it. I found that if I don't go past the edge of pain, if I stop, I can recover faster, so that's what I've been focusing on. I'll play virtual reality for a little while, and then sit down and play some World of Warcraft or Final Fantasy, and then go lay down, put an ice pack on it. So I've been easing through it. The first thing I wanted to talk about this week is I put a picture. Well, we talked earlier about the update for my Intel iMac. Well, I figured out that it looks like it's not that it doesn't support the Intel. If you look in the show notes, which can be found at controlaltwow.com, which forwards to controlaltwow.blogspot.com. The actual thing, blurb, said that it doesn't support anything below 10.15. So right now I'm updating my iMac to 10.15. And, you know, I'm so used to playing WoWie podcast that I had to go and get my laptop to play. So I'm playing World of Warcraft on my laptop and Final Fantasy on my laptop. The difference in my whole setup, and I know this doesn't make any difference to anybody else, but I did have my PC here, and I was playing World of Warcraft and Final Fantasy on the PC and streaming it to twitch.com/aprilian.car. I mean, Aprilian Car. But I can't do that with the iMac, so I moved the PC into the living room because this is so crazy. I was using Wi-Fi and I was getting lag with any virtual reality. And so at one point, which was really ridiculous, I was actually running an Ethernet cable from one side of my apartment to the other. And then I got nervous because if I tripped over that in the middle of the night, it would be really bad. So right. I just moved the PC over by my router. And so now I'm doing VR in my living room. So this is no longer my VR room. I don't know. I'm calling it my storage room.
Right.
And I put, if you look in my notes, in the show notes, you'll see the difference in the speed, and it's almost ridiculous. With the plugged into the router, I'm getting 886 down and 845 up.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. With a ping of 4.
Nice.
Yeah, that's ridiculous. And if you look on the
wire, I have something I would quickly want to interject. Please go ahead and snip those two pictures and remove your location info.
We could talk about this when we're done, because nobody can see this right now.
Yeah, but your IP address and that stuff.
Okay, sure. I'm just saying we can do it later. Nobody yep. sees this yet.
Yeah, I'm just saying it's.
I understand. Okay. There we go. It's gone. Yep. Sorry, I didn't think of that, but thank you for letting me know. Mm-hmm. But I just love that going in. I have a fiber optics Fios, so it's really fast. But trying to, I still needed to record in here for right now. I may move my desk and my whole recording studio out into the other part of the house later, and then I'll be back with my other setup, but I also can't stream. What is it asking me that? Okay. Anyways, in the show notes, the first picture I put in, I don't know if I ever explained and if people were curious as to what I actually look like when I'm playing my VR games. And so that's me with my headset. It's become second nature to me. It feels comfortable when I'm wearing it. But I guess if you were to just start playing VR, it might be a little weird and uncomfortable. Has either of you tried virtual reality?
No.
No, I haven't.
Okay. So this particular headset, this was the one I had at home. And actually, this was the one I had at work. And it has like I put a new set on it so that it has like a special piece that sits, that piece on the front that sits up there and gives me stability. It's called kind of like the, it's called the halo set, because it's like your right. sits on your head. And if you look at the picture on my left is a, I thought I brought it in here, but I didn't. It's a Bluetooth adapter that lets me use my Apple AirPod while I'm using the headset, so there's no delay. And the AirPod, I used to have to wear something like this plugged into the headset to get the AirPod, but this cable always felt like it was going to fall out, and sometimes it did, and I had to adjust it. But the Apple AirPod actually works very well and doesn't slip out, so that's one of the things I've been doing this week. In Population One, they are... I wish a lot of games could take their cue from this company. It's called Big Box VR. They change everything. Every couple of weeks, something new comes out, some new game mechanic, new skins. The last few weeks, it was Death Team Match, and now War is back. And I wish I could 100% explain the difference. Death Team Match is... two groups of six fighting each other. And when you died, and this is why it was called Team Deathmatch, when you died, you respawned with a specific set of weapons of your choosing, and then you went back. And it was, you just tried to kill as many people as you could, and when you got to 30, whoever got to 30 first, 30 before the other team, one, and it was intense and fast, and it was in a confined area. Now, War is the whole map again, but it's nine people versus nine, and you don't get respawn, so you if you die, you have to depend on someone else to revive you. And that's one of the key things in War is the reviving, because... you start off with nine people versus nine, and whenever someone is killed, it means that's less power you have. So you want to get people revived as soon as possible. And without being able to explain, it's controlled chaos, and it's so much fun. Now, one of the things that Big Box does as well in Population One is they are big on skins. You know how we can customize ourselves in World of Warcraft and in Final Fantasy? Well, instead of having individual things like hat and hair and stuff, you buy or you earn a specific skin. And I showed four of the skins that are out this week, next 2 weeks. A couple of them, ones on the left, the two on the left, you have to actually buy. The two on the right, you earn from participating in different features they have in a game. Like right now, I'm hoping I'm explaining it clearly. Right now, they're having a core thing. So what you have to do is find these cores, and they're these little glowing things, and they give off a sound. And then you take it and put it into one of the core receptacles, which are located around the map. And when you do that, two things happen. You get a point for putting in that core. And everybody on your team gets a point for putting in that core. And a weapon comes out. And after teammates put in three or four cores, you can get up to a very high-end, what's called a red weapon. That is like the maximum weapon levels. Each weapon you can find has a different level. I know I'm not saying it clearly, but it's really exciting. It's really fun. And that's what's going on this week. Each time you put in cores, after you get to so many levels, you earn a skin for your guns. And then the final skin is the lower right-hand one, which is a really cool skin. I think that one of the reasons why they are able to be less laggy and fast and everything is because all of their skins are server-side and their own. There's nothing different. They're all this, you know, if I wear that lower right-hand skin and somebody else wears that lower right-hand skin, it's pulling from the same file on the server. There was a question among some people, why don't we make them more customizable? And I tried to explain that if I had to change something on my skin, it would cause the system to have to repaint it, and it would cause lag. We're fortunate on World of Warcraft that we can, you know, wear whatever skin we want and however we want. But we pay the price. There's a lot of downloading and uploading between the two, if that makes sense. Anyways, let's go on to my week. I'm pushing towards level 61. They also started. I've been playing War and Team Deathmatch last week, War this week. I've been winning a few. When I first logged in last week, I kept losing because I didn't have my mojo, and I finally got my mojo back, and I got to play with some really good people. If you want to check those out, it's on my YouTube channel, YouTube/AprilPVD. And last, they have a special, this came from out of nowhere. Population 1 had a login reward. And I don't know if it's maybe to get people coming back who haven't logged in for a while. But if you log in for 3 days in a row, you can get the gold, you can get some Bureau gold, which is what you use to buy skins. You can get a new skin for an MK18, and then you can also get this special Haze skin that's very unique. So that was kind of interesting. On World of Warcraft, I finally got to the end of my last account. And I re-upped it for 3 months, although I think I should have re-upped it for 6 to get the bonus stuff. And me is dinged level 33. April PVD has been running around doing stuff. And Aprilian and all my other tunes, we are leveling. And I've been fishing on my Final Fantasy tune. On Final Fantasy, and it's a different mechanic from World of Warcraft, but I've been enjoying it and understanding it. One of the neat things about it is that just by putting the fishing pole in your hand, your bar changes and you get to do something different than when you have another weapon in. So that's a neat thing that they did with Final Fantasy.
Yeah, your job changes with your equipped weapon.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's so neat and so simple.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I think that's been about my week. If you are interested in anything with virtual reality, let me know. And if I can explain it better, I'm really excited because it's really starting to take off, and I think that it's going to be the new console of the future. So, anyways, that's been my.
And you explained it pretty well.
I'm sorry?
You explained it pretty well.
Oh, okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
And that's been my week.
I find it very, very easy to be true.
I'm on a schönsten Forest of Zuhause.
Granagus, how's your weekend gaming been?
My weekend gaming is has cost me a couple of souls under a couple of shoes since I started. Well, let's begin at the top of the show notes. There is this meme going around. It basically says, have you heard of the critically acclaimed MMORPG Final Fantasy XIV with an expanded free trial, which you can play through the entirety of Realm Reborn and the award-winning Heavensward expansion up to level 60 for free with no restrictions on game time? So, yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
Is that real?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's how it works. And the other day, why I'm bringing this up is I have been trying to see what I can do with as a non-subscriber on my WoW accounts.
Oh, interesting.
Just for the fun of it.
Right.
What I can do is obviously log into my Bantoons because they're all level 1.
Right.
And since a starter account or a unsubscribed account is turns into a account with starter privileges or whatever you want to call it.
Right.
So you can log into and play and do whatever you want, basically within the restrictions that the starter account has up to level 20.
Right.
Which is, yeah.
You can't earn more than 10 gold, so if you already have it in your pockets, you're good. But if you want to list something on the auction house, you can't.
I think you can't even use the auction house as a starter account, right? You can't send gold. You can't send mail. You can't even access.
Right.
Well,
you can't whisper high-level people, basically.
Yeah, yeah. You can't have, I don't know what, you can't join a guild.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you are a unsubscribed full account, you'll still have access to the guild, obviously.
Right.
But as a non-guilded toon, you won't be able to interact with anyone. What you cannot do, not at all, is log into Classic. Wow.
Oh, really?
Nothing at all. So access to Classic WoW, regardless of it being the vanilla era or TBC Classic, does require a subscription.
Subscription, yeah.
You can access any and all of your toons on a PTR server, regardless of their level.
Mm. Oh, interesting.
Yes.
I mean, very nothing permanent, but you could try stuff out.
Yes.
Or see what's in your bags.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah. So, yeah. Those are the three things that are tested out. It's interesting that they allow you to test on the PTR. On characters that are higher than level 20 when they don't do that in the game.
Well, because it's not permanent. Nothing you do on PTR is permanent.
That's right, but still, it's. I would assume that it's an account setting versus a a server setting because it's a live server versus a PTR server. Mm. So it's not an account-wide setting. That's what I'm trying to get at. Your account is, as I said, a starter account or a unsubscribed account, which makes it account. So it's not, but it's not account-wide. I'm not sure if I make myself clear. It's interesting to see that they have that aspect, differentiating aspect. I'm not sure why they've done that. Maybe because they want as many testers as possible.
Probably.
Yeah.
And especially high-level testers.
Yeah. So
maybe they think if you go to PTR and you really like it, you might come back. You might resubscribe. Yeah,
obviously, yeah.
Yeah.
So for me, the interesting part is... look at Final Fantasy XIV, it has the entire A Realm Reborn, which is equivalent to vanilla, to play through on a free trial. When you look at WoW, you have a quote-unquote arbitrary number of levels because you cannot play through the entirety of vanilla content in 20 levels. So it's interesting. That aspect is interesting. I would think that if you were to restructure Chromie Time in a way that you could play until level 50.
Oh, interesting.
But the base attunement that you get when you leave your starting area is vanilla content. And so now when you come out of your starting zone, your Exile's Reach, you have to attune through Chromie Time to attune to Cataclysm to be able to access the dungeons that are the vanilla dungeons, because Cataclysm is the expansion where those were added, where the whole world changed. So if they were to do that, and then they would say, yeah, if you want to play anything that is expansion content, then you need to go to Chromie. But to be able to access Chromie for Chromie Time, you need to have a subscription.
Right.
So you can play on Azeroth, Kalimdor, Eastern Kingdoms, up to level 50.
Right.
And if you want to continue or play something different, that, in my opinion, would be the better version of a trial account, of a starter edition. And it would keep people more interacted, because again, 20 levels it's not even two zones worth of questing.
Mm.
So, I mean, it's something
are you able to access your heirlooms as a trial account?
You cannot have any heirlooms because you can only have amount of gold that is not enough to buy them.
No, I mean, if your collection already has them,
right? If you like,
then it's not a trial account.
Okay, what if you're unsubscribed?
Of course, you can. Sure. Yeah, you can.
Okay.
But again, you can because they are not items; they are in the UI,
right?
In the tab that you right-click them and they are created,
right?
So you can do that, yeah. But yeah, again, if you are a trial account, you can obviously not do that because you can't get them,
right?
So just something I was thinking about the other day when I watched a fellow content creator talk about the parallels that I'm now drawing between WoW's trial account or WoW's starter edition and the trial account of Final Fantasy XIV. So then again, you have the other MMO RPGs that are like Guild Wars 2 or SWTOR that have free-to-play options, where it's a totally different thing to go into those ESO, the same thing, trial account, free-to-play option. That's totally different, obviously. So, yeah. I just wanted to bring that up, that I was wondering why the different restrictions on different server types in one and the same game.
Right.
Then I wanted to talk about a content creator in the Final Fantasy XIV community, Lulu Streamer Highlights channel. It's the Fashionista YouTube channel. And what Lulu does is basically, together with Skeffy, they collect streamer highlights from streamer clips that are sent to them. Comprise a 10 to 15 minutes video of funny, curious situations that streamers run into, like funny deaths or other stuff that happens. They are not family friendly, not safe for work, so be aware of that. I'm going to say that because we have a clean tag on our show. Mm-hmm. I'm aware that is not that. So be aware that if you go and visit them, it's not that. So, but since it's quite a unique thing that I haven't seen in the WoW community yet. And I find it so wholesome. I find it so great that this channel, I've watched almost all of the videos from the last 2 years by now, over the period of the last couple of months. You can see that at the beginning, there were only 1, 2, 3 different streamers that Twitch streamers that were featured in a 6 to 8 minute video. And slowly but surely, you saw that when the migration from WoW happened last summer, you could see that slowly but surely they came new faces in the nuclear from new streamers into the setting, into the stream highlights.
Oh, right.
Cool. And it's really helped to make those new streamers known. And yeah, streamer highlights, that's what it's called. That's what the highlighted. And so it's really nice that you really see a influx of new streamers and the building of communities around those streamers. And I haven't seen that with WoW streamers. Not that there aren't any, but this support in that way I haven't seen with WoW or any other game. Maybe because the communities already exist. That's obviously a big part. I'm not kidding myself, and I'm not going to say that the WoW community is less because of that. It's not. Absolutely not. I'm just saying that the growth of the streamer community in Final Fantasy has been happening, I want to say, in no small part to this YouTube channel. And that's why I wanted to mention it and highlight them myself. Mm. Because many people that play the game play by themselves. Obviously, some people watch other streamers. Not everyone is as outgoing and watch social interaction streams. They might watch guide videos or whatnot.
Right. To learn something. Yeah.
Yeah, to learn stuff. Exactly. But things like that, I wasn't the person that watched videos like that. I watched streamers, yeah, sure.
Right.
But I had my 2, 3 streamers that I watched on a regular basis whenever they streamed or whenever I had time. Mm. But not much beyond that. And now I have at least doubled my pool of streamers that I watched in the last few months. So and it's just wholesome to see that this community has grown and that people really embrace, learn to love their game and interact with the game and help each other and play with each other. It helps. It
right. just and helps. It's also to grow interesting the community. To see the game from someone else's viewpoint.
Oh, yes, definitely. Yes, sure. Absolutely. It's something that that is very, very interesting. So I need to put in, because Lulu uploaded a new video today, so I haven't gone ahead and added the new video from today, because the way that they went and did it, release, I thought they were not going to release one again today, but apparently they released one tonight, so I have to, or I am going to provide the link to the newest video so people can watch the newest video and that's that. As for my week in the game, I watched something that I knew existed, but I haven't talked about yet. It's on Twitch as well, and that's something that was new to me. Was new to me when I came over to Final Fantasy XIV. I mentioned earlier, like previously, that we have the letter from the producer, those interactions between the devs,
right,
and Yoshida-san and the community. Every once in a while, but this is what I'm going to talk about now, is the Unending Journey, which is basically a Final Fantasy XIV community stream on Twitch, on the Final Fantasy XIV channel. People from Square Enix sit down with the players and they play together.
Oh, how nice.
Yeah, so I haven't seen that happen ever in WoW.
Right.
And again, they might have their reasons. I'm just saying that it's a community building thing. If you want your community to get to know you and get to you want to interact with them or whatnot, this is a perfect way to do it. I'm not saying WoW is supposed to do that. I'm just saying it's a great idea. Mm. That's all I'm saying. And they had their last one, the most current one was, I think, 2 days ago on Friday, I think, if I remember correctly. The time, days are like blurry when it comes to people that are retired. So when every day is, when you don't have to work, you tend to forget what day it is. Like weekday, so yeah. Then I have a video where this goes back to something that I want to talk about later. what I'm going to talk about this now, and that's a triple triad. Complete beginner's guide for triple triad. Triple triad is a card game in the game that you can play, that you can start in the gold saucer.
Right.
And then you can basically go around the world and find NPCs that are can be opponents. You can play tournaments in the gold saucer, PvE and PvP. It's a card collection game as well. So there are no, well, there are a couple of quote unquote loot bags where you can buy card packs. You only get one card though per pack. So, but it's random. So it's technically a loot bag. But you can only buy them for the gold saucer currency. So not for the in-game gil currency. Yeah, and then if you run dungeons or raids, you can get cards as loot as well. And then there's a the whole strategy thing. It's really interesting. I really like the game. I thought I wouldn't like it at the beginning. A couple of streamers really liked it in my early days of the of playing the game. Apparently, it's a game that has featured in other Final Fantasy games. Since 14 is my first game, I wouldn't know.
Right.
So I'm not going to assume that I know what pretend that I know what. Other games have featured Triple Triad, the same as Chocobo Racing. There's at least one other game. Which one, again, I don't know, that has had Chocobo Racing. So, yeah. All my crafting jobs are now at least 71. So I made the jump from all crafting jobs being 63 to now 71.
Oh, congratulations.
Thank you. The next bracket is going to be much tougher. I'm not sure if it's going to be 80 or 81. I have to consult a different guide now because the guide that I was using so far only takes me so far, and so far is 80. So optimizing my gear and not wasting gil to get to 90, because that's the current maximum level, takes a different approach. And I haven't figured that approach out yet. So what I'm doing currently is trying to do a couple of quests here and a couple of quests there, and some turn-ins and some dailies, and slowly but surely level a profession here and a profession there or job, so that I think Culinarian is my highest at the moment at 74, something to that effect. I'm crafting the tools that I need for the 71 plus content myself. Previously, I bought them on the market board, but now we are getting to the to the bracket that is quite expensive, and I'm not going to waste my guild on buying tools for 40 to 60K when I can craft them myself for a fraction of that. Plus, I can get experience points from crafting them.
That makes more sense, definitely.
That makes more sense, exactly. So that is why I'm slowly but surely grinding, because I'm collecting the mats that I need to craft a tool, and then crafting them. So it's gathering and then crafting, and that's going to takes a little longer. And I'm in no hurry get to any specific point, because there's so much to do, and if I want to get somewhere, I'll make an effort, but without the incentive, I'm just going along, seeing what's around the next corner, and I'm thoroughly enjoying myself playing the game. I bought the level 70 crafting gear for the crafting scripts, which is the currency that you get when you turn in some work. When you have this system that I talked about previously, it's called collectibles. And there are NPCs around the world, mainly in cities, major cities, that accept these collectibles that you either craft or gather. And then you get scripts, the currency, either gathering scripts or crafting scripts. And those you can use to buy either gear or mats or other things. For example, I bought music scrolls for the first few thousand scripts of each, so I could get those out of the way to do the collecting first. And then while I was doing the turn-ins for the for the custom deliveries that I've talked about over the last few weeks, where you get this story told when you have six turn-ins per week, and every six turn-ins you get a new chunk of story. There are five chapters, so to speak. Those turn-ins that you make are collectibles.
Oh.
And the higher quality they are, the more scripts you get as a reward for turning them in. So it's between, I think, 140 and 180 per turn-in.
Mm.
I think something to that. I think 180, I think, was the highest I got. So if you have six turn-ins, you have, 12 overall, you have 12 turn-ins per week overall on your character, but you can only turn in six per story per NPC per week, so you can cover up to or as few as two And as many as, yeah, I don't know how many there are actually. What I've done so far is I've done all the six that I could on one NPC. So I progressed through the story as fast as I could.
Right.
Which means that I worked in tandem on two different stories. Those I finished now, the first two, from the one I got a mount as a reward at the end. And the other one, what did I get there? I can't even remember. But it was really, the story was so cool and very, very satisfying, the ending of it. So regardless of the reward, it was really, really cool to see an addition and a closure of a story of NPC story chain that was unfinished. So yeah, now I'm working on a second one, or third and the fourth one. One is Monago. She is a NPC in the second expansion. The Stormblood expansion. And without spoiling too much, her story has a family featured.
Oh.
Remember I talked about that girl in Ishgard that I didn't know what happened to?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that I mentioned that was that was prominently featured in the in one of the stories. Yeah, so a parallel to that is Monago's story features a family that was introduced. Members of that family were introduced in ARR, so in the base game in 2.0. And so now what I assume is the conclusion of that family story happens now, two expansions later. So it's not so they haven't forgotten about that story chain that wasn't finished, kind of. They already picked up on the story in the main story quest, but now they pull the dot at the end of the story, so to speak. They write the last chapter of that book. I'm only at chapter 2 now out of the 5, so I'm really curious to see what is going to happen. I put a every time you level up your rank in that in these stories, you get a new the terminology reflects of what these NPCs think of you, how they feel about you. So with Monago and the second chapter, it says Monago is pleased with your efforts. She now considers you a supporter of the Resistance Widows and Orphans Fund.
Nice.
Wow.
So it's you can see like in what
a reputation with the
yeah. So NPC. You can see in what direction story wise that goes. So yeah, it's it's bound to be tearful, and I'm all for it. It's again, Miss Ishikawa, the lead narrative person, the main story writer of the game, is just, yeah, she's insanely good.
Yeah,
and it's just, yeah, you can truly see that there has been poured into that game, in no small amount. So I talked about the elephant that I was chasing,
right?
As the mount for one of the tribal quest chains rewards. Yeah. Yeah, I got that now. If you look in the show notes, you can see me on. Well, you can see my tune all that well, but you can see the elephant on all that much better.
Very nice.
So it's white. It's a white elephant with a purple and gold what's it called? Thing on the back. It's not a saddle, it's just a piece of cloth. No, I don't know. Anyway, it looks absolutely awesome, and I'm really happy that I finally got it. Yeah, so now the next one I'm chasing is what's the next one? I think what is that thing called in English? Let me just translate it really quick. It looks pretty much like a dandelion.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
So imagine a dandelion, a flying dandelion.
A flying dandelion, okay.
So, and you hold on to, are wrapped around the top part.
The fluffy.
You basically
part.
Float on that, on the top part of it. Looks so cool.
I bet.
So yeah, that's the next one that I'm after, and it's from a crafter's faction. Well, you have these tribal factions that are, and I talked about this before, that you have battle factions and crafting factions and gathering factions. For story and for the respective jobs to progress them. And this one is a crafting faction from the Heavensward expansion. So, yeah, really, really looking forward to that. I'm going to post a picture once I got it. There are a couple of quests where, and it was the same as with the elephant, where you get to quote unquote borrow the mount that you eventually get as a permanent mount that you can obtain. But I feel posting a picture of me only borrowing it would be cheating, so I'm not going to do that. Mm. Yeah, so I found out that there is a new, not a new, for me it was new. Remember I talked about the items that you could get to boost your experience gain for crafting and gathering by 150% or 17 or 18 hours?
Right.
Right.
Or a specific experience pool. And the first one, the lowest one, is max level 40, after which it's cut by two-thirds. So it's going down from 150% to 75. No, it's a half. So it's 75% after that. The second one was 70, or a larger XP amount for the same amount, 18 hours. And now I found that when I searched through what I could buy for the scripts that I talked about earlier, I found that there is a level 80 item that apparently they added now when we got to level 90. And that is gives you again 150% up to level 80, and then it's halved to 75% for the rest, or 2 million experience max. So once you hit either once you get past the 18 hour mark, that's how you want to say it, once that 18 hours have run out, or you reach the 2 million experience mark, which apparently is 2 million XP bonus. So you would have to, the 150% bonus amount would have to be 2 million, not the original 100% included. So it's only the 150% bonus that counts towards the 2 million. And it costs 30 scripts, regardless of what type of script it is. If you want to have it for gathering, then you buy it with 30 gathering scripts. And if you want it for crafting, you buy it with 30 crafting scripts. I reached a couple of new ranks with some beast tribes,
right?
Tribal quests. I got to rank 3 with the dwarves. I got to rank 4 with the Moogles. And I got to rank 8, which is the max rank, with the Pixies. And the Pixies is the one where I got the Porksy, the flying pig, from.
Right. Wow.
And,
congratulations.
Thank you. Which you get once you get to rank 7. The rank 8 is just so you get the conclusion of the story. There is no additional reward. And if I remember correctly, if you finish the reputation for all 3, because there are always 3 factions, except for ARR, where there are 6, I think, with each expansion has 3 tribal factions, because again, one battle, one crafting, and one gathering. Then you get a special quest that I think gives you a mount at the end. You did the impossible, you did all the things, so you get the big meta mount, so to speak. I think that's what it is. So I'm looking forward to, because if I remember correctly, it's one of the mounts that I'm really after, and I really look forward to getting. It's quite significant in a lore from a lore perspective as well. It's quite touching. So if I remember correctly. I mentioned that I finished the first two custom deliveries that I started on. Mm-hmm. Both the third and the fourth that I'm working on, both involve orphans. So it's quite sad topic. Hopefully it's not going to be the conclusion. It's not going to be as sad.
Right.
So, I'm looking forward to every bit of story that I can get. One of them, the other one, I don't really have a connection to that person yet. I think I missed something, like some story bit that I didn't pick up on previously. So I think I have to read up on some things, or I have to play that content again, which, again, if you want to replay something in Final Fantasy XIV, or if you can go and do that by choosing New Game Plus, which is a replay feature in the game. If you want to experience it again, or if there's something that you aren't sure about, and again, like me, you need context for again, and the only way is for you is to play it again, then you go and open New Game Plus. If you want to rewatch or any of the cutscenes that you watched in the game, you can go to your inn and open the book, Unending Journey, and then choose the quest that has that cutscene in it, and it will replay the cutscene for you over and over 100 times if you want to. If you want a screenshot with an NPC in that cutscene, or if, again, whatever you want to do, again, I mentioned this, I think, before, if there are multiple choice aspects in a cutscene, you can go and replay it as many times as you need to choose all the multiple choices, if that's what you want, to see what outcome it has whenever you choose a different option. So, then the other night I finally finished my first relic weapon, my first ARR relic weapon, which is... A relic is a type of, if you want to compare it to WoW, it would be a legendary or artifact.
Oh, okay.
Artifact. So it's like the highest level of weapon that you can get. Mm. It's quite involved. Not as involved as I thought it would be, but that might be because they nerfed it, or because it's the lowest content possible. I'm level 90 and the content was level 50.
Right.
Normally you need 8 people to go into this trial.
Right.
To kill this one boss. And that's 3 different trials. Now I go in, cough at the thing, and it tumbles over. So yeah, basically that's something where you basically it's it's still something that I wanted to do. At least get one relic weapon.
Right.
Get the achievement cleaving to tradition. Because it's an axe, so cleaving to tradition. Obtain bravura, which is the name of the weapon, in the quest A Relic Reborn. Sadly, though, you cannot put a relic weapon in the glamour dresser.
Oh.
So you have to carry it around, put it in your on one of your retainers or whatnot. You can't, at least not yet. You can't, they might change it some time down in the future. What you can do, if you want the appearance, you can go and buy a replica at a vendor. And that replica you can put into your glamour dresser, armoire, something, and then have it be glammed over your currently equipped weapon. And the final thing I want to talk about is my new project in Final Fantasy XIV, which is why I thought of getting the Triple Triad Beginner's Guide in here. And that project I named Project Preferred Server or Preferred World. So what a preferred world is basically a world that is marked as preferred, which means it's the server that is designated for new players.
Oh.
So when you log into your server list in WoW, you have these different tags like RPG, normal PvP, or PvP not anymore, but yeah, those different types of servers. And you have the ones with new player or new player, the blue. And the preferred status for a server is a non-permanent status for when a server, when other servers are close to getting full, I think, or when a server isn't as full as others. So, what is a preferred server other than that? And what makes it? What do you get out of being on the preferred server with a new character? Because the preferred status only matters if your tune is a newly created tune while the preferred status was active.
Oh.
And it's only active. The preferred status only applies for as long as the preferred status is active. What you get is very simple. You get a buff. That buff is the Road to 80 buff. Mm. And that gives you 100% bonus XP.
Right.
Plain and simple. With everything. Usually, bonus enhancing or bonus rewarding features like buffs, like from like food, from like the 150% bonus I talked about, are limited. I said earlier that you have to buy a crafting item for crafting scripts, which only covers crafting. If you now want to have the bonus for gathering, you have to buy the gathering equivalent and use that. But that means that the crafting one is overwritten. You can't have both.
Oh.
If you have items that are that reward bonus experience, like helmets, like rings, like the earrings, they all, most of them, only work under conditions, like only work on jobs that are combat jobs, like war jobs or magic jobs. Some only work till level 10 or level 20. So I have here on my character, I have one ring increases EXP earned by 30% when level 30 or below, but only equipable by disciplines, the disciples of war and magic. So if I want to craft or gather, this ring doesn't do anything. The earring I have from pre-ordering Endwalker, same thing. Experience, the XP earned increased by 30% when level 80 or below, only for disciples of war or magic. Again, crafters don't get anything out of it. Gatherers don't get anything out of it. The only one where it works is the friendship headpiece that gives you 20% when 25 or below. And if I think there is the other headpiece works as well. Yeah, but that's level 10 or below and gives 20% as well. Helm of Light. So once you are level 25, you are done with when it comes to bonus. Other than the 3% that any food gives you. But the road to 80, experience earned while below level 80, period, gives you for experience increase for anything you do, be it killing mobs, be it gathering, be it questing, anything. So if I go and turn in, if I do my work order, my leave quests, which is basically I go and accept, I'm going to an NPC, a leave NPC, and they tell me go and bring chamomile tea to this other NPC. And I have three chamomile tea with me. I go to the NPC, and they gave me 10,000 XP for it, just to arbitrary number. I can double that by handing in a high quality one. So that means that I can get 20,000. If I have the road to 80, I get 40,000 because 100% plus the bonus is not is 10 times 2 times 2 is 40,000. And you can see how much faster you can level then. So I wanted to see, since I saw this, it's marked as a with a golden star next to the world name, the indicator that that it's a preferred world is the gold star. And I noticed that on my data center, Louisois is a preferred server at the moment. So I thought, yeah, I might as well do that. Having a character on another world on the same data center isn't half bad. I can play with other people and be in another free company eventually. Right. But I can still go back to my world if other people that I'm playing with now need help or whatnot. So it's within the same data center. So I am currently to let you know how much of a boost it is. I currently have 5 jobs. I started this project 2 days ago, 3 days ago. No week ago.
Okay.
So my progress through the main story quest, I'm currently at level 21 when it comes to the main story quest progression. My lowest job that I have currently, that is not a crafting job, I have a job in every role. A tank job, one healer job, one melee job, a crafter, and the gatherer. So one of each. My lowest job is a culinarian at level 12, botanist at level 14. My lowest is battle job is a healer at level, is a conjurer at level 27. Pugilist at level, DPS at level 28. And my tank is 34. All that just while doing the 21 levels of main story progression. Not one job tagging along main story, but 3. Mm. So you can see how much that 100% bonus plus the gear that I have. I'm not going to discount that, but I'm not going to unequip that either. Because that ad, I would have worn that anyway. So yeah, it's absolutely interesting to see, fascinating to see how much that 100% bonus
makes a difference, makes a big difference.
Makes a difference, yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. So, I didn't think that I could support 3 jobs while doing that. So
Good job. No pun intended.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and all of the three need their own set of gear. So I need to support three
gatherers.
No, I need three different, five gear sets.
Mm. Right.
What I wanted to see because you have your healer gear, your magic gear, you have your war gear, your DPS gear, and then you have your tank gear, which is a whole separate. Well, in the lower levels, war gear can be used for tanking as well. But as soon as you get to level 30, which I'm with my tank, I'm at now, 32, and I'm just at level 30 with regards to the warrior story class quest. I'm just about to get my job crystal to make the Marauder a warrior, so that's when the tanking gear comes in, when the difference becomes noticeable between the physical DPS gear and the tanking gear. It's not obviously not as significantly noticeable, but the higher you get in levels, the more significant it'll be. So if you have your avoidance or whatnot as a tank, you need that obviously. So defense. And whatnot, it is something that I need to take into account, that I have to gear all three jobs types. I'm not going to go and level another or a magic job, at least not for the foreseeable future. Because that would add much more complexity to it. And I think three or five jobs is enough for the project's sake. Once the Road to 80 project is over, I don't know what I'm going to do with the tune yet, but I might then eventually get a couple of more jobs, but not so far. I'm not planning on making any other or unlocking any other jobs. So I'm the only one I might add is fishing as a second crafting gathering job, because I need it for the conjurer to cook. For the not the conjurer, the culinarian,
right?
So I don't have to buy all the fish on the market board. So that would be the only concession that I would want to make. Might want to make when it comes to an additional job, eventually. So yeah. Yeah, that's basically what I've been up to in the last couple of weeks.
I have mail. How do I find a Moogle thingy?
You have mail. You go to... where are you?
Right now, I'm in...
In Limsa? Then you have to go you have to go back to Limsa Lumensa. I'm not sure. I'm not too familiar with. Wait, if you're in Western, no, that's Western Thanaland. No, I don't know. If you go back to Limsa Lumensa, and you teleport to the aft castle and then walk up the stairs, and then cross the circle that's there, and that's where
the Moogle,
where the Moogle is.
Okay, thanks. All right, let's just give a shout out to Kyle. I know he's doing a lot of end of the year stuff, and we look forward to his next blast from the past. me just turned 34. Just being 34.
Ooh, awesome.
So we're doing pretty good. All right. We'll be back next week. We look forward to next week. Mm-hmm. And thanks, chat room. Anything else we need to add before we sign off?
I don't think so.
This is Aprilian for the Horde and for Population One.
This is Constrax for the Auction House Everywhere.
And this is Pink Vanegas, Rule of Acquisition, number 19. Satisfaction is not guaranteed. Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.
Bye, chat room. We have a lot of people on the chat room.
Yeah, that's nice. Nice chat room. Thank you, chat room.